All right, ladies and gentlemen, as promised, we have Yehuda Remer, also known on the socialist media and the internet as the Pew Pew Jew. Pew Pew, Pew Pew. Welcome, Yehuda. Thank you for joining us today.
Yeah, absolutely. It's great to be back. It's been a while.
Yes, it has. What is your shirt? I see gun control is, and I don't see the bottom. Gun control is not kosher. There you go. It is not. It is not kosher. All right. So did you make it? Did we miss you at NRA or were you not there?
So unfortunately, I didn't make it this year. NRA a lot of times. And again, I'm not expecting them to cater to the Jewish world, but a lot of times it coincides with Passover.
Gotcha.
Passover ended Thursday night. The NRA show started Friday. And for me to brush and try to make it, plus I'm not going to be there on Saturday, and it's just not worth going just for a Sunday. So
there you go. It was actually way early this year. Normally it's like April 29, 30 and May 1st or the 30th and the 1st and 2nd, something. For whatever reason, they had to push it up a couple of weeks this year.
So. Yeah. So it was annoying. I mean, I enjoyed going, and I've never been to Indianapolis, so would have been a cool trip to go to, but it is what it is. I've become very used to it, missing a lot of things that happened over the weekends. Just comes with the territory, and you know, yeah, it's my choice. So,
right. So, Jared's got some questions for you, and well, the main thing is one of the recent posts that you put up, and he wanted to ask you about that and have you elaborate on it.
Yeah, I was scrolling through the Instagram, and I saw a really cool picture of his great grandfather holding a picture of his dad, holding a picture of him, and then holding a picture of his son. So there's four generations of the Remer family right there. And I thought that was a fascinating picture, and it was enough to stop my scroll and make me actually read the description. And the description, what was the most powerful out of the whole thing. So I just want you to tell that story about your grandfather being hidden in the ditch, and then, you know, fast forward to 45 years later where your father was actually able to recover the body.
Yeah. So my great grandfather, who I did not get a chance to ever meet, he died during the war. He was a livestock farmer back in a place called Kolome. And it was on the like Russia, Ukrainian / Polish borders, like all wrapped in one, depending on, you know, the moment in history. And a poor farmer came to my great grandfather and said, "Hey, listen, I have bought so many live, you know, not cows and stuff to work the fields. And every time I buy one, it dies." And then he didn't buy it from my great grandfather. He just bought them from around. Dies. He goes, "Do you have anything, even a horse?" And my great grandfather's like, "Yeah, I actually have a horse that I can sell you." And the farmer's like, "Unfortunately, I just don't have the money." So my great grandfather basically said, "Hey, don't worry about it. One day you'll pay me back." World War II starts, Nazis are moving in, and around that area, it was getting really bad. And my great grandfather, with my great grandmother, my grandfather, and my great uncle, went to the farmer and said, "You need to hide us. We can't get out. You know, Poland, this area has been surrounded, and we need your help." And the farmer, without hesitating, said, "Absolutely," especially because the horse that my grandfather gave him literally was a workhorse. I mean, changed everything for the farmer, hit the farmer's life and his family, because they were now able to work the land and produce food. So on the land, there was this big farm, a barn, and the farmer hid all four of them in a ditch that was smaller than most people's dining room table. We're talking about maybe like 6 feet across by like 4 feet wide, like really small. And you had two adults and two children in there. My grandfather was, I think, like 14 at the time. And from there, the farmer put them in there, put a gigantic pile of hay and locked them up there. And they were there for 19 months living in this ditch. They were only allowed out for 1 hour every night as long as the coast was clear, just to stretch their legs. And yeah, they were there for 19 months. My grandfather tells me the story how when he was finally liberated from that area, he took his shirt off and it basically crawled away. There was so many lice and bugs living on it. His skin was so damaged from, you know, never being able to bathe or things like that. But in during those 19 months, my great-grandfather unfortunately died. Wasn't killed, just malnutrition and I mean, literally living in a ditch. So he passed away. And one night, my grandfather, who again was 14, I think 14 at the time, maybe 13, something like that. Him and the farmer's son went in the middle of the night to bury my great grandfather. Now, what's interesting is the farmer had just planted on his property 3 trees. You know, weren't big, but my grandfather has always had this weird sort of, I don't know, call it a I don't know, maybe it was a peripheral issue, I don't know, but if you had 3 things, 1, 2, 3, or if you put up 3 pictures on the wall, he was never able to line them up straight, never centered them. Everything was center right. So middle of the night, they dug a ditch, threw the body in, covered it up, and that was it. And they literally threw the body in. My great-grandmother, my grandfather, and my great-uncle all survived the war, eventually making their way to America. Funny story about their trip to America. When they got to New York, the customs agent's like, okay, where do you want to live? And they're like, New York, because that's really the only place they knew. This was 1946. And the customs agent said, I'm sorry, New York is all full. You need to pick somewhere else. And you need it's to either full. Pick. Well, I mean, if you think about it, right, you had hundreds of thousands of refugees coming over since the war ended. So he's like, yeah, we can't house you here. So my grandfather is like, oh, so where can we go? And he's like, well, you can either move to Los Angeles or Dallas. And my grandfather turns to my great grandmother and says, we need to move to Los Angeles. And she's like, why? And he explained to my great grandmother, I mean, she knew, but he explained that the word Dallas in Yiddish means poor. So why would we want to move to where poor people are? He figured people in Dallas were all poor, and that was why the city was named that. So they chose Los Angeles. Funny thing is, I now live in Dallas, right? Like years later, my wife and I moved from Los Angeles to Dallas just because it's much easier to do what I do. When I'm like, oh, look, there is something that's highly illegal in California, but totally legal in Texas. Definitely helps with me being who I am in the know. And so they moved to Los Angeles, and in 1991, I don't even remember. I've read the article a million times, but I just don't remember the years. In 1991, my father, and there's a lot more to this story than you know what I'm going to tell you, because this is like a series, would have to be a series to get into the nitty gritty. But in 1991, my father flew to Europe, and I mean, it was a crazy story, you know, getting stopped at the Russian border, bribing the guards with cigarettes, like American cigarettes. And like, it was a whole thing. And my father made his way to the farm that saved my family. And they knew my father was coming, and he gets to the farm, and it's been 45 years, and they want to excavate the body and bring the body to Israel, to bury the body in Israel. So how do you find a body that's 40, you know, that's been in the ground for 45 years without a marker or a gravestone or anything? So my grandfather told my father, I buried the body next to three trees, right? Those three trees that the farmer had just planted. So on the property, my father found the three trees and he's like, where do we start? And he's like, you know what? We're going to start center right, because my grandfather was crazy, right? Like everything, nothing could be centered. Within a few hours, they found the first bone. And finally, they found every bone except from the knees down. The legs were completely missing. And they were like, they're like, oh my God, like what the hell, right? Like it's been 45 years. No one's touched this area. How come the legs are missing? And then my father realized that when my grandfather buried his father, they didn't have time to dig 6 feet down and laid the body out. They dug literally a hole, dumped the body in. So instead of excavating this way, they had to excavate down. So my father dug, you know, a few feet down, and they ended up finding the legs as well. At the end of the day, they found every single bone, including every tooth. And my father was able to bring my great-grandfather to Israel and bury him in Israel.
Man, and that's a powerful story.
Yeah, it's a pretty crazy story. And I've thought long, so many times, like, I want to put this into a book. But I my hands are so full with so many things right now. Like, I'm working on three new books simultaneously. And now just this morning, I thought of a new book and I'm like, immediately message my illustrator. I'm like, okay, give me a price list. I want this book done in the next year. So, you know, I'm working on so many things right now, but I need to just sit down and I write children's books and blank books. So it's kind of hard for me to sit down and write an actual book that has words in it. That isn't for a 6-year-old. So I need to kind of find a good ghostwriter who I can lay out, you know, the story and have them write it.
Yeah. Do you ever find that if you don't have a book in the works, that it feels wrong to you?
Yes and no, because I feel it's not that it feels wrong. It kind of feels more along the lines of, have I peaked? Right? Like, I have eight books out, right? And from my first book, which is a book about gun safety for children, which thankfully is still doing well, to my last book. And it's been about almost 2 years since my last book came out, right? My bullet points book, which is still pissing all the right people off. That book, you know, it's been 2 years, but I have one manuscript completely done. I need to find someone who will sponsor it. You know, I need about $5,000 to get it sponsored. Not super easy. You know, there's not a lot of people who are like, oh, we'll give you $5,000. My next book that I thought of this morning, $5,000 that I need. That one might be a little easier because it's going to be, if you would see this book that I have in mind and you wouldn't know who made it, you would look at it and be like, oh, it had to be Yehuda. Absolutely. Like, no one else would think of a book like that. So that book might be easier to find. But to answer your question, it kind of, if I'm not having something in the works, it kind of feels like I've peaked. And I'm like, oh, shoot, what am I going to? That's it. I'm, you know, eight books in. But, you know, my dream is to, I would love to hit 10 books in my life. If I can say, you know, at my deathbed that, hey, I've published 10 books, that's a pretty cool feeling. So it's definitely doable because I'm only 39 and I already have eight. But
yeah, definitely. For sure. Yeah, you'll get way
more. And you already have the concept for two more. So
Yeah.
So it's fun. It's fun. I love it. I'm going to keep on doing it until they shut me down or I'm just like, okay, I'm done worrying about getting more books out, that kind of thing.
Yeah. I think Dad, correct me if I'm wrong, but I think he's got like 31 published titles now or 32.
Yeah, it's over 40.
Over 40 now? Holy cow.
Oh, yeah.
That's crazy. I don't, he's a writing fool. I don't understand how he does it. I don't have any books published under my name yet. So,
no, I have, I get this feeling like, and it's funny because 10, 12 years ago, when I wrote the Student of the Gun book, and someone said, well, they asked me in an interview, they're like, well, what's the next book? And I was like, I don't know. I haven't thought about it yet.
Yeah.
But now, actually, I published my first book, what was it, 97, Jared? I think it was 97. And then I went several years. But now the process, yeah, it's funny how your brain changes and how things change. And I'm at the point now where if I don't have a book in the works, like if it's one's just there's done and there's not an open document that is a new book, I feel like I should. I feel like I should be doing it. And so I started another one the other day. And it, well, I started another one. It's almost done. But yeah, it's funny how things change. And, you know, you people, when I started writing magazine articles way back when, we used to kill trees and sprinkle ink on them and staple them and sell them to people. You know, selling your first article is amazing. You know, the first time someone gives you a check for an article, you're like, wow. And it seems like it's like almost an unattainable dream. And then later on, you realize like, oh, one isn't really that hard, because everybody out there, even, you know, if you're listening to me right now on the treadmill or in your car or wherever you are, everybody has one story, right? Generally, everybody has one story worth telling. But the trick is to be a writer. You know, what did Billy Crystal say in Throw Mama from the Train? He would close every class with, remember, a writer writes. And the trick is not the one, the trick is the two and the three and the four and so on and so forth. How do you continue to be productive? That's the hard thing. But we talked about all of that. And people who are new, you're like, okay, that's great. You got this special guest and he tells a personal story about his family. What the heck does that have to do with Student of the Gun? Yehuda, what does that have to do with Student of the Gun or guns or firearms or, you know, it's a nice family story, but.
Because it spurred me to become the Pew Pew Jew. And like my best selling shirt says, people with ARs don't get in cattle cars. So, you know, it's definitely lit a fire under me to become a Second Amendment activist, to be out there fighting for our Second Amendment rights, for everybody. Don't care who you are. Everyone has a right to the self-defense. So it's just kind of built. And the funny thing is, it's never like the story about my family never really inspired me to get into guns. What got me into guns was just I really enjoyed action movies growing up, and then my buddy took me shooting, and I was a spoiled little Los Angeles boy, and I'll admit that. And I never cared about the Constitution or politics or this, you know, the State of the Union or anything like that. And finally, when Obama started running in 2008, I kind of started paying attention, and I realized, I'm like, whoa. Here I thought all Jews were Democrats. I'm like, no, I'm not a Democrat. Hell, I'm not even a Republican. I'm like a 3% Tea Party patriot, you know, hoorah, mother effer. You know, like I'm like all.
Oh, you're an extremist.
Yeah, I'm an extremist. and then from there, I kind of, you know, bought my first gun. I was, again, living in Los Angeles, bought my first gun. My parents found out, freaked out, even though I was married and out of the house. And from there, I was like, you know what, if I'm going to be a gun owner, I need to be a responsible gun owner. And that means I need to make sure my kids are safe. That kind of led me to write my first book, because there was nothing like my book on the market. And then when I was writing my book, 27 Words, which is an introduction, well, not an intro, it's more of a breakdown of the 27 words of the Second Amendment for children. I was writing that, and I was talking to a Second Amendment historian. And he's like, you know, you're kind of like the Pew Pew Jew. And, you know, from there, it just was like, all right, full throttle with the Pew Pew Jew. Let's get a logo. let's just work hard in getting that up and running. And one thing led to another. And you know, my first book, I didn't even think I'd ever be published ever. Like, no one ever thinks they're actually going to be published. Especially, I had horrible, horrible self-esteem growing up, like horrible self-esteem. So I was like, yeah, you know, I'm just a loser. I'll never amount to that much. I'll get married, have kids, be a, you know, accountant or some freaking Jewish job that we all have, and Jewish accountant, right? And you know, I that's what I thought. Honestly, that's what I thought until, like, all of a sudden my book was published after 5.5 years of trying to get my first book published. And the next thing I know, you know, I have people like Alan Gottlieb Masada Yub all, you know, giving me endorsements and saying, oh, this book is fantastic. It needs to be in every children's, you know, every household in the country. And I'm like, whoa, hey, ho, you know, slow down there. I'm a nobody. Like, stop building up something that will come crashing down. Or getting my hopes up, if you will. And all of a sudden I'm like, wow, I have one book published. Let's write more. And I released 4 books.
So which title was your first? Was it Safety On or the ABCs? Yeah.
Safety On was my first. Safety On, the coloring book version, was my second. Then I believe was the ABCs of Guns. 27 words. No, I'm sorry. Let me backtrack. It was Safety On coloring book. ABCs of Guns. Then came 10 Little Liberals. Then came, then came 27 words. Then 10 Little Gun Grabbers. Nope, sorry. Back one more. 105 explosive gun jokes. 105 explosive gun jokes. Then came 10 Little Gun Grabbers, and then came bullet points.
All right.
It's pretty funny. You went from not thinking you were going to have one book published to really having trouble remembering which order they came in.
Yeah. Like I said, it's crazy. And you know, my entire brand is based on, you know, I like to say, think grunt style for Jews, you know, if you will. And, you know, I have just a lot of self-deprecating stuff. Everything is Jewish and pro-gun. But, you know, like I said, I have a lot of non-Jews buy my stuff. Like, this shirt right here is great because I have so many people reaching out to me. They're like, hey, we're not Jewish, but is it okay if we, you know, is it appropriate for us to buy that shirt and wear it? I'm like, it's anti-Semitic. I'm like, it's anti-Semitic if you don't buy it, you know? So,
like, are we allowed? Yeah, you're
yeah, no, I get that all the time. I get that all the time. Are we allowed to buy your stuff if we're not Jewish? I'm like, yes.
Oh,
yes,
take your please. Money. Thanks.
See, you're nicer than me. I would say no.
That's no. funny. So no, what do you think? Why do you think that a lot of Jews nowadays are aligned with the Democrat Party and the Democrat values when clearly they're taking us on a path that is similar to what led to the slavery?
Well, that's again, you know, a whole series of podcasts in itself. But in short, you kind of have to go back into history where you have Jews in Europe. You know, you have the pogroms and you have murders and rapes and stuff like that. And if the Jews would retaliate, if they would kill a Cossack, for example, Cossacks would come and kill 100 Jews for one Cossack killed, right? So Jews in Europe just tried to keep their head down, and whatever happened, right? This is just what God wants. Just that's it. Flash forward to, you know, the 1920s, and you have, you know, the deal, what's that, the New Deal and the Second New Deal, or whatever it was called, from FDR. And then was it FDR? I don't, honestly, I'm so tired. But you get my point. You have, you know, all these social programs. Then you have the Holocaust. You have the Holocaust, and that hundreds of thousands of surviving Jews made their way to America after the Holocaust. But they came with nothing, literally nothing, not a penny in their pocket, and whatever clothes were on them, that was it. They get to America, they find a place to live, and they're like, well, how do we survive? But you have all of these social programs in place that can help them. So which political party was the one that brought that on? It was the Democratic Party. So you have all these Jews now becoming, and again, this is just a massive nutshell of an answer, right? Like there's a lot more to it. I don't want people to think like, oh, it wasn't that simple. It wasn't that simple, but this is just to save time. And now you have a bunch of Jews in America who are completely devoted to a party that is continuously giving them things to help them. And, you know, the 40s happens, the 50s happens, then you have the 60s, and Jews are still Democrats because, hey, my father was, you know, my father came and the Democratic Party helped him, so we're Democrats. And one thing led to another, and Jews have just remained Democrats, very pro-Democrats. Now, a lot of Orthodox Judaism tends to be more Republican and right-wing because they are, you know, a lot more right, you know, right to life, pro-life, and they, Republican Party tends to be more of the religious party, right? More of the Judeo-Christian value party. So a lot of Orthodox Jews tend to swing right. But that's really the nutshell of an answer why so many Jews still rely on the Democratic Party. But keep in mind also, a lot of Jews nowadays are what I call gynos, right? They're Jews in name only. Mm. Right? They worship the liberal party. To them, it's liberalism over Judaism. So Judaism comes a very distant second.
Oh, that's very yes. common. Not just with it's not just with Jews or it's with everything. It's like how does a woman who claims to be a feminist support the Democrat Party, which is overpopulated with rapists and people who treat, you know, how did women support Bill Clinton, a serial yeah. rapist, right? You could just name the group because it's always liberalism over everything else. It's liberal first, feminist second. It's liberal first, Jew second. It's, you know, whatever it happens to be. It's the same thing with Christians. You have people who pretend to be faithful Christians and vote for Democrats. The cognitive dissonance there is staggering. It's staggering. But that is the lie of well, Michael Savage said it best. Liberalism is a mental disorder.
Yeah,
it literally is. It's a mental disorder that people embrace. And because that's the default is to allow somebody else. You know, there's the difference between and I really get sick of the whole liberal conservative thing. But the fact is, we have to have some type of labels to describe things. But right. When you have somebody who says, oh, I am a fill in the blank, you know, I'm a Christian, I'm a Jew, whatever. And you're like, yeah, but this group that you're associating yourself with is they're contrary to everything you claim is your values. You know, it's like sportsmen for Biden. You know, they came up with this. They started that crap with Clinton. Sportsman for Clinton, and then they moved it to sportsman for Obama, and then right. like sportsman for Biden. I'm like, first of all, that's not a thing. That's yeah. like that's like Jews for Hitler. You know, that'd be like the rabbi saying, you know, this Hitler guy's got some good ideas. You know, he's into kindergarten and stuff. He wants everyone to have a car. He's going to build good roads, and we're going to be able to drive super fast on them. What's your problem?
Trains yeah. will be on time yeah. and everything.
Yeah, people, the nice. Trains. Yeah, that was, yeah, that was hold on, Mussolini. Mussolini.
Yeah, Jared, so what?
Jared, I'm texting you right now. I came up. It's not for public, but I'm texting you right now.
Okay.
This is a sure way that if anyone comes at you with any Nazi jokes, Holocaust jokes, or any kind of anti-Semitic thing, this is a sure way to shut them down because they will have no response. I came up with funny. That.
Yeah, that's funny.
Right? Like,
No, the, yeah, short-lived movements, like yeah. You know, sportsman for Biden. Yeah, that's sportsman for Obama. Sure, okay.
So I need to take a hard left turn to go back.
Take a hard left. Or hard right.
The family story that Yehuda shared earlier. Did you ever get to talk to your grandfather about what the will to live was? Why did they stay in the ditch for so long?
No, he tried not to talk about it. Every now and then you would get snippets of it, but he wasn't. He was very anti living in the past. What I mean by that is I have three older cousins and I have an older brother. And a lot of times after an Orthodox Jewish boy or girl graduate from high school, they go to Israel for the year, right? To a yeshiva or like a girls' seminary type of thing.
Yeah.
And when you're in Israel, there's a lot of organizations that will take you on these Holocaust oriented trips to Poland, Ukraine, Prague, Germany, all these places. So all my cousins wanted to go, my brother wanted to go, and every time they would mention it, you know, my grandfather in his like deep, deep European accent would go, "If you go back to Europe, I will drop dead." Right? Like that's it, right? And they're like, "Well, great, now he's gonna die if we go." So like no one ever went. When I was in Israel for my year, I basically called my parents. I told them I'm going, and if they tell my grandfather, I will disappear in Israel and they'll never find me again. I'll literally run away. And my parents were like, "Okay, fine." Even though they were kind of against it, but they were like, "Okay, fine." When years later, we're talking about 10 years later, we were all by my grandfather's apartment. We're all hanging out. And I don't remember how it happened, but someone kind of let slip that I'd gone to Europe, to Poland, Prague, and Ukraine. And my grandfather, so my full name is Gershon Yehuda. My first name is Gershon. So my grandfather, I'm named after my great grandfather who passed away in that ditch. So my grandfather was like, "Gershon, you went to Poland and Ukraine and saw what the Nazis did." And I'm like, I'm going to own it, right? I'm like, yes, Grandpa, I did. He goes, "I'm so, so proud of you." And my cousins and my older brother were all like, "What the like, what?" And I'm just sitting there, you know, feeling like a million bucks. And he starts asking me about it. But only a few years later, he started coming down with dementia. So we never really got to talk to him. But what was crazy, though, is my other grandfather, my mother's father, his story of survival is ridiculous. I mean, we're talking about he was in 11 different camps at age 14. He was pulling gold teeth out of bodies in Auschwitz. And his story is crazy. But when he made his way to America after the war, he never talked about his time. He saw, his father was killed in Auschwitz. He was liberated by the Americans, so felt a immense gratitude to the point where joined the Air Force and worked on like some top secret radar MiG thing in like the late 50s during the Korean War. And we first kept from him that I had gone to Europe. We just didn't want to upset him. But eventually, my grandfather was an amazing photographer, and I get a lot of my photography genes from him. We're talking about he had like a Leica M3 that's in pristine condition, which I actually have up now. And if we're talking about like original lenses, not a dent, scratch, original Leica case. Like this is from 1954, this camera, to the point where if I approach like a Japanese collector, I probably can get 30, 40, 50 grand for it.
Yeah.
Like that, it has a light meter. I mean, we're talking about all of it. So my grandfather saw when I went to Europe my first time, I took pictures for myself of Poland and Ukraine. And the head of the organization that I went on saw my photos, and my second year in Israel invited me to become the official photographer for the trip. So that's I cool. made this, yeah, it was very cool. I was like 18, 19. It was like my first real job. I was like, why is he asking me? I don't know what the hell I'm doing with the camera. I'm still shooting on automatic. Like, I didn't know how to use the manual mode. And but at the end of the day, my grandfather saw this book of pictures that I made. And he's looking through the book, and like my grandmother and my mom, my dad are like freaking out. They're like, he's going to just go ballistic. And all of a sudden, like, tears start rolling down his eyes. Again, because my other grandfather was hid by farmers, you can't really say he was part of the actual Holocaust, right? He never was in the concentration camp. And I mean, again, he was part of the whole Nazi persecution, but he was never in a concentration camp, or never really was in that scenario, where my other grandfather was actually in, he went to 11 different camps, including Auschwitz. He had the numbers tattooed on his arm. So he had all this stuff. So he's all of a sudden he's looking through this book and he just sees tears. And he's like, you know, Yehuda, come here. And I sat down next to him and he's like, did you go to Europe and take these photos? I'm like, yeah, Grandpa, I did. You know, I felt it was very important for me to go see what happened to you and document what I saw from my own eyes, not through history's eyes, but from my own eyes. And he closes the book, and like I said, my parents and my grandmother are standing like 5 feet behind him, and he just starts a lot of information. We're talking about like I said, pulling, like he was 14, pulling gold teeth from dead bodies and telling me stories about what happened. And all of a sudden, like I hear everyone like bawling in the background, but like they don't want to say anything because they want him to keep talking. And after he was done, he kind of just quietly went upstairs and kind of disappeared for the rest of the day. But my grandmother came up to me and gave me a huge hug and kiss and said, I've been married to him for 55 years, and I have never heard one of those stories.
Wow.
Yeah, it was crazy. So, you know, that definitely, you know, back to bringing it to guns, you know, I have a, and it's a very weird thing to say, I have a very rich history, Holocaust history, that's part of my family. And that definitely has helped me become who I am today. I am vehemently pro-gun. I will not, I mean, 2A absolutist. I mean, to the point where in my safe upstairs, I even have a Walther P-38 with Nazi insignia still stamped on the gun that I was able to get my hands on.
Oh, that's a cool piece of history.
It's a great piece of history. And you know, I bought it for two reasons. I used to work at a gun store, and the World War II veteran came in, and my boss bought it, and I just turned to the boss like, I want it. And he gave it to me for an insane deal. I mean, I think it was like $375 he gave it to me for, because he knew.
Wow.
Or maybe it was $400, because he knew.
Either way, yeah.
Yeah, he knew that the reason why I wanted it. And he was like, yeah, I can probably make, you know, I think he bought it off the guy for like $300. But like, he knew, like, is the $700 that he might make worth the reasons why I want it?
Yeah.
And now my kids have seen it. You know, I bought it for two reasons. A, there's no bigger F you to Hitler. It's like, right? Like, literally no bigger F you to Hitler. But also I as that's the Jewish aspect. But as the Second Amendment activist aspect, I want my kids to understand that even though the eagle and swastika are stamped on the side of this gun, that a gun is a tool. And in the hands of the Nazis, it was used for evil. But in my safe, if I ever take it out, in our hands, it will never be used for evil. In other words, a gun is a tool, nothing more. And it's a very good history lesson for my children to help them understand the importance of the Second Amendment.
Yeah, that's a fantastic lesson. How old are your kids?
My oldest is 13. Then I have an 11-year-old, a 7-year-old, and then Satan Reborn is 21 months.
That's funny.
Yeah, my baby, if he was my first, my wife and I would have been one and done. he is my older three were near perfect children. I mean, never had an issue. They were just, I mean, hey, we want to take a nap. So like go upstairs. They would go into their beds and take a nap without like telling, like just the perfect children. Never complained, never whined. But then this last one is he's like Satan reborn. When he starts really bothering me, I yell at him that I'm going to use the 2-year return policy on him.
Put that thing back where it came from.
Yeah, but I love him. He is chubby and cute, and he is just one of the funniest kids I have ever dealt with. Not just my kids, from my nieces and nephews, and he is just mischievous to everything, and I love it. So it's just a pain.
It'll be good for you. Yeah, I've read a lot of stories. I have a few books back here that are written by kids that were written as an adult, but they were kids that went through the Holocaust and went through several different camps and whatnot. So reading those books, I've always wondered, well, it's made me realize that the human like desire for survival is extremely powerful. But also I've always wondered, what is the will to survive for people that are going through something like that? Is it their family? Is it because they want to take an ice pick and like say, F you, I made it through this, to the people that did it to them? I don't know what.
I guess everyone has their own reasons. What I would say is, if you read Viktor Frankl's Man's Search for Meaning.
Yeah.
Right. And he talks about his idea, which he created, called logotherapy. And the notion is, if you can find one thing, no matter how small it is, that is worth living, you can overcome absolutely anything. And again, it can be for everyone, it's different. But, you know, if your drive for living is so that you can buy that freaking Ferrari that you saved up for, now you and I might be said, you know what, screw it, we'll die over that. You know, we don't care. But for someone if that means enough to them, that their will for survival and for living is that strong that they want to buy something like that, they'll be able to do it. And I read that book when I was in Israel, and Man's Search for Meaning is absolutely a life-changing book. And if you haven't read it, I cannot recommend it enough.
You know, I suppose this is something that I could ask Dad, because he's been in situations multiple times in his life where he had to find the goal to survive the situation. And if that's something you don't want to talk about on the radio, then that's fine. But if you do, then that would be awesome.
This may throw this hand grenade at you.
Yeah. I pulled the pin and I threw the grenade to you.
Here you go. Catch. No, I get, I, the main, the, well, the thing that helped me, first time I was in combat, was, and I talked to a lot of combat veterans after this, and they said that the thing that they did was they cleared the deck mentally. They removed everything that was superfluous, everything that wasn't necessarily required for to do the job, and they just pushed that away and focused. I have not read Man's Search for Meaning, but I can tell you this, that it's that mental focus, and it's the ability to focus and have the clarity that is absolutely needed. And I think a lot of people in our world today have a hard time because there's so much clutter and there's so much distraction. And we really do our children a disservice by allowing them to fall into this web of clutter and distraction and in essentially meaningless nonsense, where, and we don't give them that, say, that solid foundation, or we should give them that solid foundation. We're like, look, everything else aside, everything else is, it's nonsense. Or like, what did Solomon say? It's chasing after wind. Because, you know, in the, was it Ecclesiastes? In Ecclesiastes, Solomon talks about it's all wind. It's all chasing wind. And that's what we do as humans. We spend a lot of our time chasing wind. And at the, you know, at the end of the day, you know, who gives a crap about what's going on socialist media or the Kardashians or whatever nonsense? It's just distraction. It's garbage. And we have to pull back and find out what is really important, what's really valuable in our lives. And when it comes, and just to take it all the way back to firearms is, you know, people with, there have been numerous genocides throughout the history of the world. There's the Armenian genocide, you know, there's the Jewish genocide, there's the you know, African, most recently, genocides in Africa, genocide in Cambodia, genocide in China. All of those things have one thing in common. None of the people who were genocided were armed. All these tens of hundreds of millions of people who were genocided, if that's a verb, if we can use that as a verb, genocided, were part of an armed society, an armed culture, a culture where the people could possess arms. And, you know, the Democrats and the socialists and the communists and the people who want to control us, they just skip over that part and they want to talk about other things. But that's, you know, when it comes to control, when it comes to gun control, you have to ask yourself, and if people, you know, what if people in 1935 or in Cambodia or in Rwanda or in Armenia or wherever, fill in the blank, if they would have all stood up and said, what is it about their agenda that requires us to be disarmed? What is it? What is it about this Hitler guy's agenda that requires us to be disarmed? What is it about Pol Pot's agenda that requires us to be disarmed? What, you know, Mao, fill in the blank. But we're there and we're able to do that. And we can say, what is it about their agenda that requires us to be disarmed? And you can answer that question for yourself. But the fact of the matter is, no group of people, no society, no culture has been genocided and been armed at the same time. And whether, you know, these imbeciles are like, I like that you know what an RIA is, right, Yehuda? An RIA?
Rock Island Armory?
No, a random internet a-hole.
Never heard that before.
That's funny. So some RIA jumped into our feed the other day and he's like, he spouted he had the talking points from the liberal left, from the CNN. If you think that you can take on the army, you've got another thing coming. You're a fool or whatever. It's like, ha. And I put laughs in Afghani / laughs in Vietnamese. Like, really? Really, homeboy?
That was probably too smart for him.
Yeah, laughing in Afghani, laughing in Vietnamese. Like, that's exactly what they did. We had peasant farmers with rifles that took on the most powerful army in the world.
Plus,
won.
Yeah, kind of what you just said, which is the thing that they don't want to say out loud when they're talking about this stuff. It's like, oh, you think you can take on the army? It's like, no, but me and a couple hundred other people like me can.
It's like they
want to imply that you're alone, that it will be you against the entire Marine Corps. That's what they want to imply and make you think.
All right, can we just take a quick break and say that just I just got totally like where my brain went. Like all of a sudden someone's talking, but no one's lips are moving.
Sorry about that, producer here.
I mean, there's literally a green box around you when you talk, and I guess you've been so quiet the whole time that all of a sudden I'm like I can't. Oh my god, yeah, whatever. That was a total mind bend just now.
He's like, "Yes, Lord."
Yeah, that's funny.
Pretty much, yeah. I'm like, is there that big of a delay? You know,
where is this voice coming?
Yeah. I got one more thing to say, and then I'll wrap it up here.
Yeah, we need to put a cork in this bottle.
I had an epiphany the other day. If you've read Plato's Republic, you know that he had what he considered the five regimes. It was aristocracy, democracy, oligarchy, which degraded into democracy, which then degraded into tyranny. And they presume that that's just the cycle of governments. And so it was kind of disheartening for me, because we're, you know, if that is the case, then we're headed to tyranny. However, I realized that we're not a democracy. I mean, I realized that a long time ago, but I didn't apply it in this fashion. There was no, we are the first representative republic. So we are probably going to be able to break that cycle, right? If we have the people that are willing to have the knowledge and that are willing to make that cycle break, then I think that we can do that. So,
well, Rome was a republic, but what didn't they have?
Yeah, they didn't acknowledge that there were inherent rights for the humans.
Yeah, Rome was a republic, but they didn't have a Bill of Rights.
Yeah.
You know, everybody in the world, freaking North Korea has a constitution. But what does that mean? It means nothing. Without rights, without God-given rights, without rights that are affirmed by your creator, everything else is just a privilege from a dictator.
How does that dictate?
Yeah, that's why we're different. That's why we have the potential to be different. And that's why they hate us so much. That's why the world's dictators and the world's tyrants, they just hate us, because we're the bad example that for their people. We're that example that, you know, they're over there doing their thing, and they're going to make our people think that they should be free too. They got to do everything they can to silence us and destroy us, and we're doing it from within. But Pew Pew, Yehuda, thank you very much for joining us today. I hope everyone appreciated it. If you don't, well, then just tough noogies. Go somewhere else and listen to something else. Get better taste. Yeah. That's right. Go get better taste and come back.
Where can people go to find the shirts and whatnot and all your books?
If you want, I'm across social media. At the Pew Pew Jew, and then thepewpewjew.com. You can get signed copies of my books, t-shirts, camo, yarmulkes, I mean, you name it. So a lot of fun stuff at my site.
Are Gentiles allowed to buy your stuff?
They absolutely are. Okay. It would be anti-Semitic if you don't buy it.
Are you all out of the AR, the boxcars?
No, those right now, everything with the AR box car, the cattle car shirts, mm-hmm. flags, all that, that's all print on demand. So as long as, but I am in the middle of having those made into patches. So
awesome.
Patches will be soon.
There you go. All right. Yeah. We got, so go to the pewpewjew.com. And you can get a kosher shirt, or you can get the boxcar shirt, or whatever you want to get.
There's one that says, I trigger hoplophobes. That's pretty funny.
Yeah, I can't believe no one has come up with that yet. I was so proud of myself. Like, I scoured the internet for a shirt like that. I'm like, how has no one come up with I trigger hoplophobes?
That's pretty funny.
So, yeah, it's definitely funny when you walk through the mall. And
it's like way up here. It's like, it's so far up. They're like,
yeah, they think like all like, oh, so you hate gay people. I'm like, no, like,
oh, you're the smartest, you figured it out. Congratulations. Yeah,
no, that shirt, like you actually have to, it's so simple, but like you actually have to get the play on words.
Yeah.
So yeah, I'm a big fan of that one.
That's good. So go get that.
How
one.
How dare you make people think? All right. Thank you very much, Yehuda, for joining us. And we're at the end, aren't we, Zach?
Yep. We could close it.